So quite a while ago, the Nintendo Switch was released and I made this video about the WebKit browser bug. I didn't really understand it well enough to actually participate in the Switch research, and a lot of it was done in private anyway. But since then we have seen quite a few releases, a nice talk at Congress, a Nintendo bug bounty, and some infighting between groups, and I have no clue. But I remember hearing about this BootROM bug and that it was apparently super awesome, though I never really looked into it. This was until Andy, Geek at Work on Twitter, told me about a talk he gave at Open Chaos, a very small Chaos Computer Club event in some random German city, and I should check it out. And so, let's talk about this. So the talk Andy gave is pretty long, with 1.5 hours. And staying concentrated and listening to it all might be hard. But this also means the talk is very detailed and can be fairly easily understood. You don't need a lot of prior knowledge. And it is kinda structured in chapters as well, so that you can easily watch and pause and continue another time. So there is no excuse to not watch it. And I really want to recommend this to you because he explains how he, together with Q3K from the Dragon Sector CTF team, approached the Nintendo Switch. They were not coming from the browser exploit software side, they tried to come from the hardware side. And so Andy is telling what their thought process was and also explains a lot about the hardware in general, how booting a system works, the different stages, basics of USB, and also about how they then tried to glitch the Switch. The title of the talk is Glitching the Switch. I had one CTF video write-up where I used an FPGA to glitch a very simple software on a simple Arduino board. But in this talk, glitching is a lot better explained and you get an actual real-life example of how and why they wanted to glitch the Switch. But enough of this praise and worship, I hope I convinced you to watch it. So, first of all, the Nintendo Switch is kinda unique because it's based on NVIDIA's Tegra X1 chip. This chip contains a lot of stuff, it contains a CPU, GPU and a lot more parts. Here you can see the block diagram of all the components. It's a whole system in that chip. The cool thing was that this chip is available for us consumers. You can buy a Tegra X1 development board which has the X1 chip on it and exposes a lot of different peripherals for you to develop and test software and create prototypes and so forth. You can kinda imagine that Nintendo might have used such a development board during early software development before the Switch hardware itself was finished. So the reason why gaming consoles are so locked down is mostly because of piracy, and a lot of security researchers who work on consoles are very vocal about not being interested in piracy at all. They are usually not motivated by free pirated games later, because that never would cover the cost of tools, hardware, and time invested into those hacks. Economically, this only makes sense for people who want to directly or indirectly profit off piracy. A lot of these researchers just do it for the challenge, so please don't support that commercial form of piracy and instead buy the games and celebrate the cool hacks that were done. Anyway, so what I wanted to say is that the goal of hacking a console is to somehow run your own code on there, or even get so far to build a whole homebrew environment so that anybody can develop games for the Switch. When exploiting a browser, you only get some user land access. Maybe the browser is even sandboxed or there are other mechanisms that make the privilege level less powerful. And it definitely is not persistent. So you would have to find more vulnerabilities to go down the layers. But of course you could also ask yourself, can you not just come from the other side? Could you not just like replace the internal hard drive or storage and just overwrite the raw Switch code with your own code? Kinda yes, that would be an idea and might theoretically work, but we have just learned that the Tegra X1 is like this whole system inside of a chip, so physical access has some practical issues. There is no like external hard drive that you can just replace, and there's also some crypto involved too. Another idea would be to use some kind of update or flash mechanism to overwrite those things in storage, but these kind of attacks are of course mitigated. There are a few security measures in place. But let's start with the beginning. Let's Andrew introduce the first step in booting the Switch.
This is the so-called BPMP. BPMP stands for Boot and Power Management Processor. And this thing is the first CPU that runs code when the system is turned on. The CPU, the GPU, and so on don't even have power when you turn on the CPU. When this core executes code, the DRAM is not configured yet, so you don't have memory. And also here is a block that's called IROM, and IROM is the boot ROM. This is the first code that this BPMP processor executes when the system turns on. And this code in the ROM is responsible for checking a lot of stuff that is security related. And this is the code that enforces that you can't just run whatever you want on this platform.
This is key. So booting a system has a lot of different steps. Modern computers are very complex and there are multiple chips and multiple little programs that will configure hardware and whatever, and eventually hand over the execution to the operating system kernel, which can then use a lot of the configured hardware to create a userland environment for regular programs. So during the different stages of booting, those stages verify the integrity of code that follows by checking hashes and signatures, or it drops other forms of privileges, like moving from ARM level 2 to level 1, or for example locking down certain memory areas that contain secrets like cryptographic keys and so forth. Here you can see how the Tegra X1 development board boots. This is very similar to the switch, but the switch obviously doesn't go into Linux. But the BPMP processor, which executes the boot ROM, is the same. So if you could somehow change the code of one of these stages, the previous stage would see that some signatures doesn't match anymore and refuses to execute it. So it all starts with the boot ROM.
The ROM is interesting because the ROM is the root of trust. If you defeat any kind of security in that ROM, you can load whatever code you want.
So running your own code here would be kind of the holy grail. And like a lot of devices that you know, if something goes wrong during boot, you end up in some kind of recovery mode.
The other path is interesting. It's called RCM. It stands for recovery mode. If the boot ROM fails to load NVT boot, for example, from the eMMC because the eMMC isn't there or it's corrupted or whatever, then it goes into this RCM path. You can also force this by pressing some buttons. And then you have an USB device that you can use to load code into the chip, and then you usually load something that's called NVT boot recovery, which then runs from RAM, and then you can talk to this thing, and you can reflash the eMMC or whatever mass storage device you have on your board or in your device where the operating system lives.
So could we just somehow get into RCM and then load our code?
Of course, we can't just use this because RCM as well enforces security. So everything that you load has to be signed with a certain private key from Nintendo.
That would have been too easy. But maybe there are other vulnerabilities. But the issue is that these parts are proprietary. There is no source code available for the boot ROM. So how could we get the boot ROM, even just the binary, to reverse engineer and analyze for bugs would help? This is where the development board comes into play. On there, you can run your own code, and it has the same boot ROM as the switch. So you can maybe run code that will access the boot ROM memory and just read it out? Well, it turns out that the boot ROM is locked down. Once your code is running, you can't access this memory anymore. And this is what Andy and Q3K tried to glitch. They ran code that keeps trying to read from the boot ROM and try to glitch at a specific moment in time to hopefully circumvent this protection. Here you can see an oscilloscope trace of the glitch attempt by Andy. In this talk, he explains exactly why they wanted to glitch at this moment and how they do it. So if you're curious about the setup, watch the talk. But so now he had a glitching setup, and now we have to try for a bit.
The glitches would do something sometimes. Maybe I'm lucky. And then on another screen, I suddenly saw this. And this was my facial expression. This is the code that was running there. It said all the time, boot ROM locked, boot ROM locked, boot ROM locked, boot ROM locked, and always checked, is the boot ROM locked? Yeah, okay, then don't do anything, wait for the reset. The glitched again, and suddenly it said boot ROM unlocked, and it started dumping stuff at me. And we're like, what? And again, we can see this actually worked.
Awesome. The glitch was successful. And now reading the previously locked boot ROM is possible. This is actually also how at least one other group acquired the boot ROM as well. Now you have the boot ROM and you can reverse engineer it in the hopes to find bugs. For example, maybe there are cryptographic vulnerabilities, so you can bypass some signature checks or they forgot to check one small thing. So multiple people and groups got the BootROM and independently started to find the same security issue. And that one is the Holy Grail vulnerability. Keep in mind, this BootROM cannot be updated by a Switch software update. This boot code basically is baked into the hardware of the Switch. That's why Nintendo had to release a new fixed hardware revision. All old Switches will forever be vulnerable to this. Here's the advisory by NVIDIA. Security notice, NVIDIA Tegra RCM vulnerability. This notice is a response to recent publications on a security issue regarding NVIDIA Tegra Recovery Mode RCM. A person with physical access could connect to the device's USB port, bypass the secure boot, and execute unverified code. This issue cannot be exploited remotely, even if the device is connected to the internet. Rather, a person must have physical access to an affected processor's USB connection to bypass the secure boot and run unverified code. So what is this bug? First, we need to talk about the RCM, the Tegra Recovery Mode. A lot of devices you know can somehow be interrupted during boot. For example, on your PC, you can like press Del or F1 to enter the BIOS, or on your phone, you can keep like volume down or so pressed, or on your Mac, you can like press the Option key during boot. I don't even know the keys. I might have just said completely wrong ones, but you know what I mean. And the Tegra also has a way to interrupt regular boot and instead go into RCM mode. This works by holding down the volume down button, the home button, and the power. The home button in this case is not the home button on the Switch Joy-Con, it's what the Tegra sees as the home button, and there is no real button exposed. You actually have to bridge the 10th pin here inside of the Joy-Con connector. So if that is like shorted, you press volume down and the power, the Switch will go into the RCM, the recovery mode. The screen stays off because it actually just communicates over USB. There are special RCM messages you can send to the board, for example to write new code. But as you can see here, the RCM messages contain crypto stuff like signatures, and you would need the Nintendo private key to actually send valid messages to the BootROM. So most of the functionality of the BootROM is implemented after messages are verified. So a lot of the more bug-prone, more complex parts might only be reachable if you could send verified messages. So how likely do you think it is that there is a vulnerability even before the message could be verified? Like during the whole receiving of the messages. Also here, I encourage you to watch the talk because Andy explains very detailed how the RCM message protocol works and how USB works. I just try to explain the gist of it. There are two parts to this bug. First, here is a loop in the RCM receive message function.
This just receives the message. It does some all kinds of sanity checks already so that we don't overflow anything and puts the header into one place and the payload into another place.
Here's the memory layout of the BootROM. This is continuous physical memory, but divided into dedicated areas. This here is the RCM payload buffer, which is pretty big. And so when you send data via USB to the Switch and it receives it, this is where your payload is placed. And here we have USB DMA, a direct memory access area. If the Switch would want to send data via USB, it would write the data into that DMA buffer and then tell the USB stack in the chip to send this USB data out. And there's an issue in one function that sends out the data. You can request some status from the Switch via USB, and this is then processed in the handle pending control transfer function. And in here, you can control a length value, which will result into a mem copy from the buffer area into the USB DMA buffer so that the data can be sent out as a response. But you control the length. And now you can combine the receiving of a large payload and the copy of data from the payload area to the DMA.
And in the meantime, it also has to handle these control transfers. At that point, we send this get status control request with that overly long W length value that we can control.
So to send out data, the data is copied from the payload area into the USB DMA buffer.
The stack is directly behind the DMA buffer. So we always copy stuff from here to here. What would happen if we copy 16 kilobytes plus 12 kilobytes from here to here? Like this. We overwrite the stack.
Boom. So overwriting the stack happens during a memcopy. Andy shows the call stack for this here. The RCM receive message function is receiving a lot of data that we can send to the switch in multiple packets and place it in the buffer. But before we complete the transfer, you send a different USB packet to call the getStatusControl function and set a large length. And you can imagine what happens next. The area you previously wrote here is copied with a memcopy into the DMA, but you copy so much it overrides the stack. You smash the stack with the data you control. So once memcopy would return, it will pop the return address from the stack and jump there. Now you can redirect code execution to anywhere you want. You have full control over the BootROM. The switch is fully owned. So if you're curious in more details, check the link to the talk in the description.